So let me turn now to our speaker. I've known Eric for at least 25 years. Some of you, or probably along with me, can recall that in 1991, this region was experiencing one of the worst real estate and banking crises in its history. Eric was the key research point person at the time here at the Boston Fed on the crisis, and he evolved in the ensuing years to a real national expert on real estate and banking crises, both here in this country and internationally. He moved from thought to action by becoming the head of bank supervision at the Boston Fed, and then in 2007 succeeded me as president of the bank. I know Eric to be highly focused, a principled leader, and someone devoted to the work of the Federal Reserve System in supporting the growth and welfare of our national and local economies. He's become an articulate and proactive member of the Federal Open Market Committee and a major leader here in Boston. Without further ado, Eric.
Thank you, Kathy. Can everybody hear me fine? I'm mic'd appropriately. Well, thank you everybody for being here. I'm so glad we decided not to have this meeting yesterday so that everybody had to come in through the snowstorm. And I'm particularly glad because I was stranded in Florida Sunday night. And JetBlue canceled all the flights and said they could get me back to Boston or Providence by Thursday. So it's not so bad to be in West Palm, but telling Kathy that I was stuck in Florida for a couple days and was going to miss this talk was going to be an issue. So fortunately, I was able to fly into Hartford. I'm glad everybody's here. Hopefully, everybody's been able to shovel themselves out and didn't have too much trouble coming into Boston this morning. I'm an economist, as Kathy highlighted, so I talk from a PowerPoint presentation, so if your back's to the screen, you may want to flip your chair around, because the screen is much more interesting than myself to look at, so I would encourage you to just flip around so you can see the screen. The last two quarters have actually been quite interesting. I'm sure they've been interesting in the various boards that you're on, in terms of the ups and downs that we've been seeing in the economy. So if you think back to the fourth quarter of last year, it was a period of quite a bit of uncertainty. And in particular, asset prices were moving in a direction that I think many people found distressing. Domestic and foreign stock prices had declined very substantially. The 10-year treasury had declined, oil prices had declined, and stock market volatility had increased. As you look at that list in that first bullet, those are the kinds of things you normally see as we go into a recession. So not surprisingly, a lot of analysts started talking about how concerned should we be about going into a recession. Since the start of this year, it's been a very different story. Many financial markets have recovered, and I'll show you some slides on this in a minute. The government that was being a bit disruptive with the government shutdown was able to come to an agreement. And of course, the Federal Reserve started announcing that they would be patient as well. That confluence of events has certainly helped in getting a much better reaction from financial markets over the last couple of months. But I would just highlight that there's still some very significant risks to the economy. As we know, we still don't have a trade agreement with China, and both China and Europe still have very slow economies. They've been weak for quite some time, and I'll show you what their stock price have been doing. But just the real economy side of both those areas has been a bit problematic. We have the potential issue of Brexit, and that's coming up towards the end of this month. And European banks never recovered, American banks did. And as a result, if Europe slows down too much or if they start having other problems, their banking sector probably is not going to be as resilient as in the United States, where we've done a much better job of improving our capital ratios. So I'm going to be arguing that this is for monetary policy. The baseline outlook remains actually quite good. So my own forecast, I'll show that later in the above two. That I'd expect the unemployment rate to decline over the course of this year. The unemployment rate's still at relatively low levels, so that would be a positive sign. And inflation, thankfully, has been very well behaved. So the PCE is inflation index, is what the Federal Reserve focuses on. And that core PCE inflation's just a little bit below 2%. It's at 1.94%. So as a result, it's a little below our target, but it's basically at target. Nonetheless, I think there are some downside risks. When you're going from an economy that goes from 3% growth to 2% growth, you do worry about it slowing down more than you're anticipating. That's partly the slowdown in the economy is partly being driven by some of the diminishing of what was going on with fiscal policy, so we're having less of a stimulus than we were before. And also we tightened on monetary policy 4 times last year. Monetary policy works with lags, so we're still seeing some of the effects of increasing the federal funds rate by 100 basis points. But the real concern that I have is actually that the slowdown in the rest of the world on top of these two end up causing more slowdown than we are anticipating right now. Fortunately, from the Federal Reserve's perspective, the overheating risk that I was somewhat concerned about over the course of last year, I think has diminished. In part, inflation's remained quite well behaved. But in addition, I think some of the exuberance in financial markets has been taken out by the volatility that we've seen over the last 2 quarters. As a result, I'm not as concerned about some of the financial stability concerns resulting in overheating. So generally, a very positive message. What are the implications for monetary policy? Well, first, I think we have the luxury of being quite patient at this time. We're expecting a reasonably strong economy. Overheating doesn't look like it's going to be at least an immediate problem. And we need to evaluate whether those downside risks are likely to become a reality or whether the downside remain a risk and that we actually do get something close to the modal forecast. So I think monetary policy at the current level is appropriate, and we can take some time to see if GDP does improve the way we're expecting and whether we have any of the disruptions from some of the foreign sector from trade that hopefully we don't see over the course of this year. So with that introduction, let me take you through a little bit of data. This first chart is just showing you the Dow Jones and S&P 500, and I think everybody knows as we got into the fourth quarter, and particularly right around the holidays, unfortunately, the stock market took a pretty significant decline. If you take it from the peak that was occurring in the third quarter to what we were seeing around the holiday season, it was roughly 12 to 15%, depending on which index you focus on. You can see that since the beginning of the year, there's been a pretty significant recovery. It was not just the United States that exhibited this kind of pattern. This shows you international stock prices, and it's indexed to the beginning of January 2018 being 100, and so you can track it over time. So the top dark blue line is the line that represents the S&P 500 for the United States. You can see that we're above where we were in January of 2018. If you look at the bottom line, which is the green line, that's China. You can see that China was much more depressed than other foreign stock prices. It's now come up, it's roughly 90% of what it was the beginning of 2018. That's mostly because there's been a very significant recovery over the last month as people have become much more optimistic about whether we're going to get a trade agreement, and as the Chinese government has started to take more significant actions to try to stimulate their own economy. So that's certainly a positive sign. China's the second largest economy in the world. So if China really slows down, it has an implication globally. So that's something that is encouraging, and you can see that Japan and Europe have also seen somewhat of a recovery. They weren't down nearly as much as China, but the recovery has been a little bit more modest. Turning to volatility, this is just an index of volatility, stock market volatility, and you can see there are basically 2 peaks in this chart. That first peak in January of 2018 was a time when financial markets had become very concerned about emerging markets in China, and if you remember back to that time, there was a lot of volatility, stock prices had declined. Over the course of the year, people became more confident, and then we had where we once again saw 18 to the full, we actually were seeing the 10-year Treasury rate rising fairly significantly. At its peak, it got up to that is roughly 50 basis points lower. So when both debt markets and equity markets are telling different stories, I actually tend to focus on debt markets. It's more of an institutional. We're remaining concerned about some of those global risks. The 10-year Treasury is one of the ways that you hedge against. If you're worried about a global stock market decline, if you're worried about foreign growth diminishing, one of the ways you might hedge against that risk is to buy 10-year Treasuries. So that may be one reason why we're still seeing a 10-year Treasury closer to 2.75% than 3.25%. But this is saying that we shouldn't be fully confident, even though some of the stock prices have come back to where they were prior to the fall. We're not seeing that same recovery in the debt markets. People talk about the yield curve and going as slow. Two different measures. The most traditional way of measuring slope of the yield curve is take the 10-year minus the 2-year. And so we're just getting at how flat or how steep the yield curve is. And at times, people became concerned if the slope of the yield curve gets too flat, or in particular if it turns negative. You can see that by historical experience over the last year and a half that we definitely have seen that spread come down. A less traditional, but one that's received a bit of academic focus has been something that's a little more short dated. So it's looking at the 3-month T-bill 6 quarters in advance relative to the current period. That's not so much getting at just inflation risk, it's really getting at what are the market likelihood path of monetary policies gonna be. And you can see that as we've been talking about the pause in monetary policy, this indication of the T-bill rate in the forward 6 quarters relative to now has gotten very close to zero, which is very consistent with our pause communication that this probably is a time where monetary policy isn't going to be taking action, at least in the near term, until some of the uncertainties become a little less uncertain. Turning to corporate bond spreads, it shows you the spread between corporate bonds and the 10-year rate. You can see that it was quite low over the course of most of last year. You can see that as we got into the holiday season, it really peaked at a very high rate relative to where it had been. It's come down somewhat, but it hasn't come down all the way. This is, again, an indication that people are still worried about credit risk at firms, particularly firms that are issuing high-yield debt. And as a result, there's still an underlying concern that we may not get as much of a recovery as we're hoping. Now, all those other charts were focused primarily on the U.S. domestic situation. But I think one of the areas China has gotten a lot of attention over the last year. I don't think there's been quite as much attention given to Europe, and I think that's really important. And so I think these two lines, I could have shown it as a spread, but I want to show the two 10-year rates. We have Germany that's been doing quite well. We have Italy that's not been doing nearly as well. And if you look at the blue line for Germany, that's a 10-year rate. So you're getting a 10-year rate that's not much above zero, which is telling you that the real return, if you do get anywhere close to a 2% inflation target, which the ECB has as being just under 2% inflation, that would imply a negative yield over the entire 10-year period. So it's a little discouraging that there's not more confidence that they're going to be seeing positive inflation in Europe. And so even though Germany has a pretty strong economy, the last 2 quarters have been quite weak. One was basically zero, and then the other quarter was a little bit negative. Italy's had 2 quarters of negative growth. Italy's at the other side of the distribution for Europe. It's one of the weaker countries in Europe. It has a concern about sovereign debt risk, and you can see the spread between these two has gotten quite wide. That's partly reflecting concern that Italy's debt to GDP has gotten very high. Its economy is slowing down. And so the sovereign risk is becoming more of a concern. Both of these are in the euro, so there's no exchange rate risk. So this is purely just looking at in Germany, they're concerned that the economy is not going to be strong. In Italy, they're concerned enough now that you are seeing that, and that's mostly reflecting the risk that Italy is not able to pay off their debt. So you see the spread widen pretty significantly. So market pricing is still telling us that there are elevated risks. Domestic stocks and foreign stocks have recovered nicely since the beginning of the year, and that certainly is positive. Volatility is definitely lower than it was when we were in markets have not attention to, and I think the Federal Reserve definitely as a result, we've been talking about being patient until we see how the global economy and domestic economy evolve. So now let me turn to the modal forecast. That was really focused on the risks. So those are hopefully things that aren't going to happen. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about how forecasters are thinking about what is the most likely outcome. And so this first chart shows you the blue chip forecast for real GDP. As I said at the beginning of the talk, I was talking about real GDP growing a little bit faster than 2% over the course of this year. And this the to my own forecast. The dashed lines are showing you the 10 highest GDP forecasts among those 50 private forecasters, and that bottom dashed line is showing you the lowest forecast for real GDP among those 50, the lowest 10. And you can see looking at the top that nobody really thinks that we're, or that the average of the 10 largest don't, or 10 highest, are not expecting us to get growth nearly as strong as last year, which ran around 3%. You can look at the bottom and see that nobody is really forecasting a recession either. So that is modest growth. Forecast. Enough that we're going to continue to see a lower unemployment rate over the course of the year. This just shows you the unemployment rate not only for whites, but for Hispanics and African Americans. The reason I want to emphasize this is there are definitely advantages to having a tight labor market. And one of the advantages is some sectors of the labor market that tend not to do nearly as well as other sectors actually tighten up, and more of those individuals are able to get jobs than they would be able to if we weren't running a relatively tight economy. And you can see that relative to where we were in 2009, African American and Latino unemployment rates have come down quite dramatically. It has for whites as well, but not quite the large decline that we saw over this period. Looks like I'm switching out, so. Yeah, it sounded like I was drifting in and out. Is this better? Or worse? All right. So it's definitely a good sign in labor markets that the unemployment rate has come down to this much. Initial claims for unemployment insurance. So you can only get unemployment insurance if you're laid off. And so this is not showing people that voluntarily leave their jobs. This is showing people that are laid off from their jobs. And what you can see is the initial claims for unemployment have really come down quite dramatically. This is very low by historical experience and is an indication that most employers, even if they see an economic slowdown, are going to be very reluctant to lay workers off because in this kind of labor market, it's going to be very hard to replace them. So this initial claims is saying that the economy overall is still quite strong. We're not seeing significant layoffs. And a very important statistic that tends not to get quite as much attention is the quits rate. The quits rate is people that voluntarily leave, so it's the opposite of the previous chart. So if you decide to quit your job, you don't get unemployment benefits.
So the reason you're going to quit your job is either that you think you already have a job or you're very confident that you will get a job. This is the way that basically wages go up. Somebody leaves one position to go to another company. The reason you do that is normally you're offered a better wage or a better compensation package. So that forces the new firm to offer closer to a market rate. Obviously, the firm, when you leave, also has to replace you, and that forces them to pay much closer to market wages as well. So this is the mechanism that you would actually expect if you had a tight labor market and you were expecting there to be more demand for labor, and as a result, wages would go up. And in fact, that's exactly what we've seen. So this shows you two different measures of wage pressures. One is the average hourly earnings, which comes out with the employment report. We'll get a new employment report this Friday. The other is the employment cost index. It's a slightly preferred measure by economists because it takes into account composition in the labor markets. But really, they're both telling the same story right now. They've both been trending up. Now, they've both been trending up, and if this trend just continued in the same direction that it was, at some point that would be concerning for inflation. The level we're at right now is 3%. That actually isn't a problematic level at the wage growth of 3%. If you think inflation's running very close to 2%, and you're thinking productivity in the economy is roughly 1%, then 3% compensation is about what you would actually expect. But if that trend line were to continue up and you were seeing 4 or 5, and you weren't seeing a change in productivity, that would be more of a concern. Now, the Fed obviously does want to see more wage growth, but you want to see it because the economy is becoming more productive, not because you're causing the economy to have more inflationary pressures. So the wages and salaries is something we do spend a fair amount of time looking at to get a sense of how tight is the labor market. Is it too tight or is it appropriately tight? Just to highlight that people were concerned about the distribution of wages and whether low wage individuals were not doing nearly as well in the current economy. This shows you through three industries that tend to have low and moderate income workers in that industry. What you can see is it has the exact same pattern, and in fact, in two of the three, it's substantially higher now than for the overall in the entire economy. So this is benefiting low wage workers as well. The inflation rate is the PCE index that I was talking about. Core PCE is just a tad below 2%. The total PCE is a little bit lower. The reason it's a little bit lower primarily is because we've had oil prices declines, and those are still feeding through the economy. So we would expect total PCE, which is actually what the Fed's inflation forecast is focused on, but we tend to take out oil price changes, which tend to be temporary. So we also tend to spend some time looking at that core inflation measure. And that core inflation measure is basically exactly where we want it, right around 2%. And that's where I'm expecting it to be at the end of this year. I just threw this chart in to highlight that there is a difference between goods and services. And so one of the important aspects is services is done domestically. You don't have the foreign competition. You can see that PCE for services has been growing a bit above 2%, and that's been offsetting the fact that goods prices have been quite depressed, in part because of trade. You can see that over the last year, it's been a little bit more positive as the trade concerns and other concerns have resulted in some of the goods prices going up, but still quite moderate relative to what we're seeing in services. So putting this all together, concluding observations, the modal forecast, the forecast that we think is the most likely outcome, is still pretty positive. We expect reasonable growth in real GDP. We expect inflation to be around 2%. The labor markets, we're going to have a labor market report this Friday, so we'll see exactly what the unemployment rate is now. It's at 4% currently. The expectation is that we're not going to continue to see as much labor force participation, people pulled into the labor market. As a result, we would expect the unemployment rate to slowly decline. Financial markets have certainly improved since the end of last year, and there's little evidence of overheating. Nonetheless, I would say that the downside risks remain elevated, and that's something that we have to be concerned about. We're seeing it. I didn't focus as much on the real side of the economy in this talk, but for example, December retail sales was quite weak. What was most striking about that report was it wasn't just in the bricks and mortar, it was also in a lot of the firms like Amazon that are more tied to the digital economy. Those firms also had some difficulty with retail sales. Presumably, there were a lot of things going on in December. We had a government shutdown. We had stock prices that were declining quite significantly. There were a lot of concerns about what was happening globally. But we need to wait and see whether that was just a temporary phenomenon or whether it's a reflection of a much more substantial slowdown than what most forecasters are forecasting at this time. So in that kind of environment where we have elevated risks, we have outcomes that are about where we want them, monetary policy should be patient. It seems like we have an appropriate interest rate for where the economy is at this time. Fortunately, the government shutdown ended. We still have certainly some international concerns. We'll see what happens with China and the trade agreement. But I think that given that we're not seeing a lot of overheating in the economy, given that the ebullience that we were seeing in financial markets seems to have subsided somewhat now that we have higher volatility, I think we can be patient. And so the message from this morning is we are going to continue to be patient with monetary policy, closely watch what develops in both the domestic and global economy, and respond appropriately depending on what we see. So thank you very much, and then we'll go to the Q&A.
Thanks, Joel. That was wonderful. So clear, so direct. We get where you're coming from in terms of the balance of risks in the economy. I was down at the Brookings Institution last week. It's kind of old home week there for an old home place for Fed people. Ben Bernanke's there, Janet Yellen, Alice Rivlin, Nellie Lang. I mean, people that we all, or Eric and I know, and a lot of you have read about or know yourselves from the Fed. And there was a big debate about Federal Reserve independence. Now, if you're a central banker, you care more about independence than you care about almost anything. Because in order for you to do the best job, at least this is a theory anyway, of setting monetary policy and supporting the growth of an economy, you need to be free, or as free as possible, from political influence. And that's what is meant by independence. I once talked to somebody at the from the IMF, and they said, you know, a cocktail party of central bankers is all one trying to tell the other how much more independent they are. So it's a big thing in central banking. And people are questioning it now, and it's not the first time they've questioned independence. I mean, it goes back decades. Lyndon Johnson driving McChesney Martin around in his Cadillac convertible on the ranch, or at least that's the story anyway. So I'm wondering, how are you thinking about it, Eric?
So independence, I think, of the central bank is critically important. There's been a lot of academic research that looks at why that is so important. And the academic research basically highlights that if you use monetary policy as a political tool, you start getting into business cycles that are tied to election cycles. Nobody wants the business cycle to be on a four-year frequency. It's been more than a decade since we've had an economic downturn. So you don't want to be in a situation where you're overly responsive to political concerns. That doesn't mean that we aren't accountable. We definitely are accountable to Congress. So Congress gives us what's called a dual mandate, which is we're focused on getting maximum employment and stable prices. And so as long as we're doing those two things, that's what we're supposed to be focused on. So we're not focused necessarily on the stock market. We look at the stock market, but that's not what we're supposed to target. We look at what's going on in the world, but our focus is on domestic markets. And so as long as we're doing what Congress has mandated to us, and we're accountable to Congress, and the chair goes up and other governors go up to Congress and talk about how we're succeeding or not succeeding in meeting our dual mandate. Right now, I would say we're doing quite well on our dual mandate. Labor markets are quite tight, as my talk highlighted, and we're very close to our 2% inflation target. That's exactly where we want to be. So as long as we're doing that, we shouldn't be listening to various discussions politically about what else we should be focused on. We have a very clear mandate, and that's what we should continue to be focused on.
So you don't pay attention to Saturday night tweets?
I do not.
That's smart on your part, I think, anyway. You made reference to something that's inherent in the whole discussion about independence, and that is the level of communication that exists between the central bank and the financial markets. Sometimes that gets a little tricky. My very first open market committee meeting was when the decision was made to tell the markets what we did when we made a change in monetary policy. It's hard to believe, but you know, some 20-odd years ago, that information was not conveyed by the Federal Reserve or many other central banks either. So a lot's happened in the communication area, and it can be a really good thing, or it can have a lot of problems associated with it that you don't perceive at the beginning because of the speed with which things are communicated now and the trickiness of language at times. I know communication has been a big issue at the Open Market Committee for a long time. Maybe some thoughts on that beyond what you just gave us?
So communication clearly is important. The way monetary policy works is that we move interest rates and then we hope that consumers and businesses react to those interest rates in the way that we're expecting them to. Well, that means that we have to communicate very clearly not only where the interest rate is moving right now, but where we're expecting interest rates to move over the course of the next 2 years, roughly a period where businesses or individuals would be thinking about, do I buy a house, do I buy a car, do I make an investment? So our communication strategy is a critically important part of what we do, and it's definitely gotten much more complicated. I think the Federal Reserve has done an incredible job of becoming more transparent over time, and I think that's been a trend in central banking around the world. The chair is now giving a press conference after every single meeting, so we have a statement, we have minutes, we have a press conference, and then with a four-year lag, we have a transcript of everything that was said at that meeting. So we do a much better job of trying to convey, but I would say that we're certainly not tweeting to the same degree, though my communications people would highlight that we do tweet from the Boston Fed. I don't think it gets the same readership as it does from other people who are tweeting at this time. So actually getting our message out still, I think, is a little bit challenging. A lot of it is done through the financial press. A lot of it's done through the news networks that focus on business type of issues. We still don't do nearly as good a job with the public at large. And in fact, over the course of this year, we're actually having a program where we're trying to hear underserved voices. We're going to have a meeting in May at the Boston Fed that's going to be focused on organizations that normally don't comment on monetary policy. In June, we're having a meeting of academics from around the country that are going to talk about what they think we should do better, including what we should do better on communications. And it's part of us rethinking about, is there anything we have to do different than in our framework? So I talked about our framework is tied to maximum employment and stable prices, but there are lots of ways you can calculate that. And so we're having a broader discussion. We haven't done this in the past. Bank of Canada every 5 years asks, are we doing the right thing for our mandate? This will be the first time that we actually are doing that. I actually had a Brookings paper last fall that was focused on this is exactly what we should be doing as a transparent central bank. And it's going to be an interesting experiment to see what happens as we try to communicate in a much broader way than we historically have.
Communication has been an issue for at least the last 25 or 30 years at the Open Market Committee. And it just seems like if you get to a point where you're comfortable, then the next month you become uncomfortable with one way or the other about communication. It's a tough issue. An issue that you referred to quite a bit in your presentation has to do with inflation. With unemployment this low, when I first went on the Open Market Committee, we would be tightening policy to fare thee well because there was this belief that unemployment levels below 4 were really going to be expansionary. Now we have unemployment rates below 4 or around 4. We have reasonable levels of growth, and we have no inflation to speak of, you know, the 2%, so we're not running really low. which people worry about, nor have we, breached that 2%, or at least not very often, over the last 3 or 4 years. So it's a conundrum. What happened to inflation? Where did it go? Tied in a bit with the issue of productivity. Where did that go, too? I don't know if you want to share some more thoughts on that.
Sure. The inflation process is one reason we can be very patient right now. So if we were seeing inflation that was going up quite rapidly, we would have a different monetary policy. So what's enabled us to, at this point, interest rates are still pretty low. So if you look at the rate that we actually set, it's set at 2.4%. Inflation at 2%, that's not a particularly high rate. And yet we're pausing instead of continuing to tighten. And in the past, we would have been tightening at this stage still because we would have been worried about those labor market pressures and pricing pressures picking up. There are a number of things. If you're kind of wonky, you would talk about the Phillips curve, which would be why we're not seeing more inflation pick up. I think there are a number of reasons. Most economists would highlight that the central bank is doing a much better job of communicating, getting back to that communication, that we're really focused on a 2% inflation rate. If everybody believes that we're going to do that, then even if something happens to push us a little bit above or a little bit below, if you're pretty confident the central bank's going to do a really good job of hitting 2%, then you don't react that much to shocks. If you don't think the Fed's going to do a very good job, you can remember back to the 70s when oil prices were going up and we had a series of wage price pressures. People were not confident, in part because of the political pressure at that time. And as a result, we did have a real problem with inflation. So if you look at a chart of inflation, it's kind of way up and down during the 70s. With Volcker, it comes down, mid-80s with Greenspan, and all of a sudden we start hitting 2% and staying at 2%. So I think part of it is central banks, both in the United States and around the world, are doing a much better job of communicating that they're really serious about a 2% inflation target when you have a target like 2%. I would also say that one of the impacts of the financial crisis is that I think a lot of people are much more concerned about unemployment than they were before. In particular, they may not be having the same wage pressures that we might have seen at other times because people still have a very strong memory of what happened during the financial crisis. So I think it's a combination of factors, but I certainly think our communication strategy and the fact that expectations are pretty anchored at 2% gives us a lot more flexibility on monetary policy than we have in the past.
Certainly seems to be the case, given the numbers. You talked a little bit about trade. A lot of people have speculated that, the reason why we had the volatility in the markets at the end of the year had to do with the uncertainty in terms of the China situation and what was going to be involved in whatever trade restrictions we would place on Chinese goods, which of course could be positive, could be negative in terms of the economy, but certainly create a lot of uncertainty. Then there's the rest of the world, which you mentioned is not growing as fast as we are, and that of course affects the demand for US goods as well. How do you see that trade situation moving forward?
So I think trade is really important. Most economists would highlight that tariffs are not a particularly efficient way of trying to promote trade internationally. And I think one of the concerns is that as you increase tariffs, not only does that raise prices for consumers, so it serves basically as a tax on consumers, but you also become concerned that to the extent that it's done bilaterally, that you start moving trade patterns to less efficient ways of actually getting goods to move around the world. So there are a lot of disruptions that occur when you have tariffs. This is probably the period that we've had the most discussion of tariffs since the Great Depression. One of the reasons you hadn't heard much about it is the Great Depression at least was partly attributed to the fact that there were tariff wars around the world, and that was viewed as a very complicating situation to get the world economy back. So for a long period of history, most countries that were at least in the developed world had moved away from tariffs. There's obviously much more focus on tariffs. If you want to take a positive attitude towards what we're doing with China, you would argue that we're using tariffs in order to make sure that intellectual property and some of the other issues get addressed, and it's more of a negotiating strategy than it is a permanent economic strategy. But I would say that it's a strategy that is not without costs. It's a cost to firms, it's a cost to consumers, and the more uncertainty there is, the more it becomes disruptive both for consumers and for businesses. And I would highlight that even though we're not as open economy as many other economies around the world, the financial flows are very open. And so you start seeing stock movements around the world occurring as you become concerned about tariffs. And so those become as important as the goods flow. So I worry about the goods flow and the inefficient allocation of resources, but I also worry about how financial markets respond. And I think December was an example of people being having a heightened concern about trade and those being reflected in financial market prices, and those financial market prices starting to have an impact on individuals.
Mm-hmm. Clearly. This is going to be my last question before we open it up. One of the things that I think has characterized the Boston Fed under your leadership is involvement in the local economy. One of the reasons we have regional Federal Reserve banks is that regions differ. What's going on in Boston and particularly eastern Massachusetts, but to some degree the whole of New England, in terms of the booming biotech economy and so forth, is not going on in the middle of the country to the same degree that it's going on here. So the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston is going to be knowledgeable about trends that the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago may not be. So one of the reasons we have a Federal Reserve Bank of Boston is to pay attention to local trends and to be involved in the community. And I know you've taken that as a major element in your mandate. Maybe you want to talk a little bit about the economy here in New England and where you see it going. We may be leading, who knows, in terms of the ebullience here. And maybe we have more risks as a result.
So Kathy's exactly right. New England is one of the regions of the country where labor markets are very tight. They are actually tighter the further north you go in New England. So if you look at Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont, they have unemployment rates that are 3% or lower in many cases. And so when you talk to firms, they're not able to expand because they're not confident they can get the labor force. All of New England has an issue with the fact that we have an aging demographic relative to the rest of the country. So that means that when labor markets get tight, we don't necessarily draw in as much labor. And particularly when I go to New Hampshire and Vermont, I hear from employers that they're very concerned that they don't have the workforce that they need, and they're having trouble drawing individuals in fast enough. So if they have to expand, they're choosing to expand in other places. So one challenge, I think, is the labor market and making sure that we get the workforce development that we really need in New England. Boston's obviously doing very well for the reasons that Kathy articulated. I would say there are regions in Massachusetts and around New England that haven't performed nearly as well. And so one of the challenges is thinking about how some of these gateway communities, how some of these rural communities can better develop labor markets so that we can really draw them into what is a very strong economy. I would also say that there are some cautions to growth, and I'll just hit it briefly, but the Federal Reserve is at the Seaport area. Kathy remembers that you used to have to walk a mile or two to find a restaurant, and you'd walk a mile from where you parked your car to get into the Fed. But now it's all buildings. Now there are a lot of good things about the fact that we have a much denser downtown. One of the bad things is that my commute has doubled over the last 10 years, and my guess is that's true for most of the people in this room. That means we need to build our infrastructure as fast as we build our population centers. And the infrastructure spending in Boston, and it's not unique to Boston, but any city that develops very quickly and one that doesn't grow geographically nearly as much has to be worried about whether we're investing enough in roads and trains and making sure that people can get in and out. One reason housing prices, particularly in downtown Boston, condo prices have gone up so dramatically is because people get very frustrated with the commute, which is kind of an infrastructure problem. So I think it's a good problem to have that so many people now want to be in Boston. This is a very different Boston than when I came here 33 years ago, where it was still somewhat of a kind of a gritty city. So it's really exciting
how Boston has improved, but we need to continue to make improvements if we're going to continue to tell a very positive story.
Infrastructure is an issue for the whole country.
Right.
Anyway, that takes us to fiscal policy, but that's another conversation. All right, now I'd like to open it up to questions from the floor. We have mics, I think. Okay, in both sides of the room.
And if people could just identify themselves when they get the mic as well as ask the question.
Yeah, that's a good idea. This is Bob.
Hey, good morning. Bob Sullivan with Corn Ferry. Kathy, I agree with you. Eric, you've done a great job with our region here. But the other area of focus that you have really excelled at is diversity inclusion. You know, I've had the benefit of doing a few searches for you, and you hold us to the fire on that. And it's proved to be a great example for all of us. Mm-hmm. The question I've got is, NECD is clearly focused here on corporate governance. You have a very interesting structure at the Fed, and I mean the Boston Fed, where you've got three levels of directors, your A, B's, and C's, combination of bankers and private sector people like the John Fishers and the Roger Berkowitzes. For the benefit of the group, can you spend a minute describing the structure of your board, and more importantly, how do you recruit your directors? What do you look for in their attributes?
So that's a very good question, because by anything, so it just gives complete independence in terms of my own decision-making for FOMC. Now, what's interesting is when I go down and vote on monetary policy at what's called the Federal Open Market Committee, when we're at full complement, we have 12 presidents and we have 7 governors. Right now, we only have 5 governors because there's continually a shortage of governors because we have to get people through the political process. The 7 governors are all appointed politically. But once you come to the Fed, you're supposed to be completely nonpartisan. It's a technical job, it's not a political job. The Reserve Bank presidents, because they don't go through a Senate confirmation, are completely independent. I don't know what the political affiliation of any of my presidential colleagues are. And a couple of times when I thought I knew what they were, I turned out to be wrong, which is a good thing, that actually politics don't play an important role. So the governance structure, I think, is critically important to our independence and the fact that we are a nonpartisan organization. So when the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston does some research and reports it out, there's no political bias one way or the other. We wouldn't pick a topic that was particularly partisan in nature, but to the extent that we do a topic, people know that we're doing it because that's what the academic research, that's what the data is showing us. It isn't reflecting any kind of partisan view. So I think that governance structure, it's a very unusual structure because it's a federated structure. I would say when you're doing things, Kathy was an expert in payments, when you tried to do things in the payments area, the governance was potentially an issue. But I would say on monetary policy, it's not an issue, it's not a bug, it's actually an attribute that we have this kind of convoluted governance that actually works really well, because it's one of the things that gives us the independence and keeps us nonpartisan.
And it's not just the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston that has that three-level structure of their board. Each of the reserve banks has the same structure. And in my experience anyway, those boards were extraordinarily helpful in both bringing, I mean, part of the reason why you have a regional reserve bank is so that monetary policy in the center is informed by what's going on in the regions around the country. How does a president like Eric get information? Well, he goes around and gives talks like this one, but he also has very well-placed people on his board who can bring information to him. And I know that was always extraordinarily helpful to me over the years. So the wisdom of putting this complicated structure together, people have tried to attack it from time to time, but I think most have come away with the same impression that you seem to have, Bob, that it's helpful overall in terms of maintaining both the regional rootedness of the Reserve Bank and the information flow to the center and the credibility that comes from that. Back there?
Good morning, Peter Rocket from Wolf & Company. I was curious how, from a workforce development perspective, how are we doing at retaining college students in our region?
Yeah, so I would say that Boston's doing much better than it was maybe 10 or 15 years ago. I think that's in part because Boston's a much more attractive city for young people than it used to be, in that it's now a locus of people. Certainly if you're in the biotech field, there's no more exciting place to be. If you're in medicine, Kathy serves on some boards that reflect the medical nature of Boston, and I think this is one of the top research places in the world to be. So that's incredibly exciting. We have really vibrant financial sector, so we have hedge funds, we have private equity, we have banks, so we have a well-developed financial sector, including a venture sector. And we have a pretty diverse economy here, so there's a lot of opportunities for young people, and it's a very attractive place for young people to stay. I would say that that continues to be a really important draw for Boston. It gives the youth and innovation that I think is a hallmark of Boston. And so I think we're doing much better than we used to do in terms of attracting young people to this area. I'd say we still, I mean, we're competing with New York, we're competing with Washington. There are plenty of other attractive places for young people to move. But I think Boston is one of those cities that's a top place for somebody in their 20s to 30s to move to. So I don't think it's nearly as much of a problem as it had been 15 or 20 years ago.
Joe McHugh, that 1.6 inflation rate for manufactured goods seemed unusually low to me. Is that the delivered cost? Last week I was with about 25 middle market manufacturing companies throughout the U.S., and they're talking about real high inflation in transportation costs and tariffs, particularly from aluminum, steel, some of the foodstuffs. It just seemed unusually low. They're talking well over 2 or 3%.
So usually when I talk to manufacturers, they talk about their costs are going up very fast, but their prices can't, and their margins are being squeezed. So I don't know if that's a situation with the people that you were talking to. But if you're selling a manufactured good that's sold globally, you're not just competing with firms that are located elsewhere in the United States. You're competing with firms that are located elsewhere in the world. And so that supply chain is critically important. What you pay for labor costs is critically important. And it becomes much harder to be able to pass on those costs because if the costs get too high, people relocate to an area of the world that's less costly. So one reason that goods is very different than services is because of the traded nature of those goods. So as a result, you're kind of competing globally for all the costs, whether it be transportation, whether it be labor costs. And so if things get out of whack, people move their location. So we have seen goods prices that are most impacted by these international flows being much more restrained than service prices, where we don't have the same global competition. When I go get a haircut, I'm not going to go to Singapore or China to have a haircut. So as a result, they don't have to worry about that global competition for haircuts, but you do have to worry about global competition for a product that's sold internationally. So I think you're right that I think the costs have been going up. Labor costs have been going up. Transportation costs, if you highlighted, have been going up. Oil prices have come down a little bit. But I think it is a challenge for a manufacturer located in the United States if domestically the economy is doing much better than the rest of the world. And I would add to that that the exchange rate matters for those manufacturing firms. The dollar is pretty strong, in part because the U.S. economy is doing better than economies elsewhere in the world.
And as you discussed, in the 70s, when we had high rates of inflation, I think businesses did not take did not fight as much to keep prices stable as they did after Paul Volcker took the actions that he took and the Open Market Committee took the actions they took in the 80s and really brought inflation down. So the whole mindset of business is different than it was, let's say, 20, 30 years ago. Maybe that is also entering into the inflation environment.
Yeah, I think that does play a role, but it's also the cost of trade has gone way down in terms of any kind of manufactured good probably has components that are coming from countries all around the world. And as that wasn't something that was happening
chain,
in the 70s,
yeah.
We were much more of a closed economy at that time.
Yeah.
As the economy's opened up, it's become much more difficult to pass on prices if it's a globally traded item.
Yeah, sure. All the way back there, just a matter of first come, first serve.
Hi,
people
Lisa.
On the other sides can join in too.
Hi, Lisa Schwartzberg at Evolution Credit Partners. Thank you so much. Your comments have been extremely interesting. You did mention a little bit about the credit markets and that you thought downside risk was in and priced in. Would love a little bit more color on that, as well as if you could speak a little bit about where you think we are in the credit cycle.
So the credit markets, one of the concerns has been that leverage has been going up in the economy overall. And so one of the reasons that you're seeing the high yield rates go up is reflective of some of the concerns of highly leveraged firms being able to weather particularly a downturn in the economic cycle. So there have been a lot of economic research focusing on credit spreads, and those credit spreads, when they get wide, are actually giving us a fair amount of information. And so the fact that those spreads widened so much in December and haven't come back in completely is an indication that we should be concerned that there's still people that think that what's maybe in our economic model an unlikely event may be more likely than we think. So if we go into a recession, those high, it's kind of like looking at Germany and Italy, where Italy was the weak and Germany was the strong. When I'm looking at a spread of treasury and then looking at a high yield, the treasury rates are going to do fine in the next recession, but the high yield firms are not. So that leverage component is something that we are continuing to focus on very closely. And the fact that financial markets are paying a little bit more attention to, I think, is actually a positive in some sense, because it means that we're probably going to have a little less ebullience, that lenders are going to be a little bit more careful, making sure that they're not too exposed in case the economy slows down more than anticipated.
Okay, back here. Ah, yes, our Brandeis visitors.
Hello.
Professor.
So this was actually, I tried to plan it after the manufacturing call, but it's a tag on to that one. Just, you know, thinking about like automation and the skills gap, I've done some research in the past, particularly on manufacturing, about how, you know, with this push to bring manufacturing back domestically and the transition from lower skilled labor to higher skilled in terms of manufacturing, maybe requiring more engineering, more high skilled labor to work hand in hand with the machines rather than it being pure like manual labor in the manufacturing side. Do you see that as a realistic push for the United States? Do you see it happening in the rest of the world, or do you still find that for manufacturing there's always going to be that lower cost option in the rest of the world and it's not really a realistic opportunity for the US to capitalize on that?
So it's a good question, particularly for New England, because we still have a very significant amount of manufacturing that occurs in New England. Particularly if you go around the Connecticut Valley out towards Springfield, there are manufacturing operations. There's more manufacturing being done in biotech, that some of it's being done in New England. It's a very different kind of manufacturing than what we were talking about 40 or 50 years ago. So this isn't working in a Detroit auto plant where you're, you know, turning some screws or knobs. You're now running computers. You now need to know a lot of math. So the workforce development is completely different for people that are going to work in the manufacturing sector. The United States has some real advantages. One, we have political certainty. We're not going to tariff ourselves so that you don't have to worry about arbitrary changes in costs coming from something like government intervention. You don't have to worry about the political risk that you're seeing parts of the world that are not nearly as stable as the United States. So there are many benefits to manufacturing, and I would say the other thing is that you're close to the consumer, and the consumer is here in the United States. Frequently, we're still the market that most companies want to be focused on because we're such a large economy and we're such a dynamic economy. So I think there is going to be a role. If the major component is low-value labor, that's not a place that we're going to be competitive. But increasingly, a lot of those jobs are going to be replaced by technology, and people talk about robots. That doesn't mean we have to be concerned that people aren't going to get jobs, but they're going to be very different jobs. And so that workforce development, the math skills in particular, become much more important. So when you see somebody in a manufacturing shop, it's now frequently in front of a computer screen. It's not sitting with tools and in a grimy setting. It looks much like a setting of many of the businesses represented in this room. So I think we still have a significant role to play in the global economy. And I think it will be more of the high-value chain rather than the low-value chain. That's completely appropriate. We want to be paying people wages that they can live on in the United States, and so we're not going to be focused on those things where labor cost is the major component.
Joe Blutman, 11. I'm curious about demographics and how you view the demographics of the United States. And we have the baby boom entering retirement age and large numbers of people leaving the workforce. How does that impact the economy, do you think, in the foreseeable future?
So demographics are really important. One of the reasons that we're not expecting GDP growth, I mean, when Kathy was president, we were talking about a potential GDP closer to 3% than 1.8%, which would be my current estimate of what the economy can grow without having more tightness in the labor market. A lot of that is the demographic changes. So even in the last decade, there's been a huge change in the demographics as the population's gotten much older. Obviously, if we don't allow immigration, that also is an impediment to having a younger workforce than we otherwise would have. We're seeing it in most developed economies. The most extreme case is Japan. So they have very slow growth, but one of the reasons they have very slow growth is their labor force is not growing very quickly because so much of their labor force is now much older. Now, one of the benefits of all the medical innovation that we have in New England and in the world is that people are able to work much longer into their life and be fully productive. So we are seeing labor force participation rate at people over 65 going up. I think that's a positive sign, but it's certainly not gonna see as many 65-year-olds as we see 30-year-olds in the labor force. So we do have to worry about those demographic challenges, and I think certain parts of the country are more affected than others. So New England is one of those regions that suffers from demographic challenge. We have less young people. If you go up to northern Maine, there are places where you go really long distance to get to a school. That is an impediment to development in those areas. And you get to a point where if you don't have a school and you don't have a fire department, you don't have a police department, you don't have a hospital, people don't want to live there anymore. And so you start seeing people migrating to cities. So you see Portland doing very well, but northern Maine not doing nearly as well. I think that's a challenge for our entire country, is to think about, we sometimes think about differences between wealthy and poor, but increasingly it's urbanized and less urbanized areas, and they're very different challenges. So I think for the United States, we are gonna have to think about those challenges and what we're gonna do in some of the more rural areas globally, and for monetary policy makers, we have to think about how the demographics are gonna change our macro economy, how fast we can grow, how tight labor markets can get. Obviously, if labor markets get too tight, we start seeing enough wage pressures that it has to be pushed into prices over time.
The demographics are so powerful. I remember the long, maybe it's still going on, Japanese banking problems, which affected economic growth and productivity and inflation rates there and so forth. A lot of that slow growth in demographics also impacted it, and the attitude toward immigration. And I think about that time, I really wonder about our attitude toward immigration now. You mentioned it, but it's such a vibrant part of the history of the United States that we grow and we change and we benefit from immigrants coming through and from their dynamism. It's awful to lose that.
It's particularly true in Boston, where skilled labor, and if you look at the graduate programs, there's a very large foreign component of that. If you can't get jobs in the United States, you stop coming to American universities. New England is one of the areas where we specialize in higher education, so not just in Boston, but throughout New England. If we become a less attractive place relative to Australia, Canada, and the UK, we do lose some very significant dynamism. And we lose people, particularly in the sciences, the computer science field, where disproportionately many of the universities have focused on international students. So I think, particularly for skilled labor, we're really at a disadvantage if we aren't continuing to encourage our schools of higher education to attract the best and the brightest from all over the world, and then making sure that they can get jobs in the United States that can certainly use the skills, and we've spent all this money educating them. we should be able to take advantage of those skills, and they're desperately needed skills for the kind of jobs we're producing.
Mm-hmm. That's so true. Yes.
Ann Mostu, Bloomberg. President Rosengren, are you in favor of a rate hike later this year if your modal forecast is realized?
So it's very conditional on what actually happens with the economy. So the reason to be patient is if I was sure that my modal forecast was going to be the outcome, it's very different than if one of these risks becomes a real significant issue. So if you get my modal forecast, which is growth doing reasonably well, labor markets continuing to tighten, depending on how much they tighten, we'd have to think about later in the year what we should be doing. But if the economy slows down much more than I'm anticipating, if inflation stays below 2%, then that's not an environment. So I think one patience basically means we need to wait and see what actually happens, and we should be data dependent. If the economy grows much more rapidly, and it is possible that the economy grows more rapidly than myself or the private forecasters expect, then that'll be an environment where tightening should definitely be on the table. On the other hand, if some of these downside risks from global growth occur, then there would be no need to tighten at the end of the year. So I think patience is basically saying we're not going to give a lot of guidance to what we're expecting down the road because there's enough uncertainty that we just have to see how things evolve.
Yeah, that takes us back to the communication topic. For the longest time, it's been very hard to communicate when you're in a data-driven situation. People want to think that you know everything, and nobody knows everything. I'm sure there are times when the economy is depressed enough that you kind of have a sense what you have to do, and on the opposite as well. But when it's the way it is now, it has to be data-driven.
I mean, I think that's a very good point. When the unemployment rate was 10%, it was clear that we needed to continue to stimulate the economy, so the direction of interest rates was very clear. I would say if inflation was picking up very rapidly, I'd also be pretty clear about what we need to do for monetary policy. But as I said in my talk, we're pretty appropriate for where we want to be. We have a tight labor market, but we're seeing inflation right around 2%. So if something pushes us much higher so that we're growing much faster, well, that would be something we'd have to react to. But if something pushed us much lower, we'd react in the opposite direction. So it's not as obvious at these times which direction we're actually going to go.
Next question. Yes.
Jim Callahan. Curious as to the we need infrastructure. Could you comment about the implications of our debt and deficit and the direction that's going? I realize that's not monetary policy, but has significant implications for the future.
So in terms of the deficit, normally at this stage in the economy, we'd be looking for ways to bring the deficit down, not increase the deficit. We have a tight labor market, and we have inflation right where we want it to be. So when you think about monetary and fiscal policy, you think of fiscal policy going first and monetary policy reacting. We have a dual mandate, fiscal policy does not. So we're given whatever fiscal policy Congress and the President adopt, and then we try to set monetary policy to get inflation and unemployment rate right. I would say that this isn't probably a sustainable amount of debt that we're adding year in and year out. And to the demographic trends that we were talking about, when you think about Social Security and medical costs of an aging population, there are a lot of costs that are going to be going up over time. So this is a good time to really be reflecting on whether we need the degree of deficit spending that we currently have. It's really important what you spend it on. So if you're building infrastructure that's going to make the economy much more productive, that's very different than if you're spending it on something that's not productive. So it's partly a composition issue as well. But I would say that continuing to raise the deficit to the degree it is probably not sustainable in the long run. So at some point, either government spending will have to go down or taxes will have to go up to make it a more sustainable. You can't be growing the debt much faster than the goods and services that we can produce in the economy overall.
Next question. Okay, yes.
Hi, Pat Randall. Back in 2007, none of us really anticipated, including you at the Fed, what was about to unfold. And can you comment now on, you seem very confident now. I think that the Fed has done a great job in getting us to where we are, but how can you sustain your confidence that you know when the right time is and what the risks are now when we didn't see any of that and you didn't see any of that coming really not too long ago?
Yeah, so one of the things that makes me more confident is I think one of the things the Federal Reserve did not get right prior to 2007, 2008 was that we were not, Kathy and I were talking about this earlier, we were not putting enough resources into bank supervision, and we were not willing to force institutions to have higher capital requirements. We were allowing too many dividends to go out at a time when markets were too ebullient. There have been a lot of changes in bank regulation. Banks are much better capitalized now than they were. That's not to say that we can see every possible thing that could go wrong with the economy. We still have to worry about it. But I think that we're in a much more stable setting than we were before. So we did get kind of the financial stability bank regulation wrong in 2004 through 2006. We have to be careful that we don't go back to that kind of situation again. But I think relative to the rest of the world, we have a much better capitalized banking system. If I were to highlight one risk that I haven't already talked about, it would be that interest rates are quite low right now. So when you think about a federal funds rate at 2.4%, and you think about in most recessions, we lower interest rates by 500 basis points, 5%. It means we're going to hit zero again if we have a recession anytime soon. And it would be in the context of, I showed you the German 10-year rates, only a little bit above zero as it is. They don't have any monetary capacity to react. Japan, same situation. So the global economy is even worse shape than we are for thinking about the next recession. So I'm not expecting a recession anytime soon, but I would say the world's not particularly well prepared for that. I'm going to give a talk in April that's going to be talking about getting a little bit more policy room. It's a little bit to the deficit question as well, that during economic downturns, you want fiscal policy to be able to respond. If your debt to GDP gets really high, you're less capable of responding. That's the situation Italy's in now. If we were to go into a big recession, Italy wouldn't have the capacity. It doesn't have control over its monetary policy, and it doesn't have the fiscal capacity to react. Well, that's not a great environment to be in. So one of my concerns is, will we be able to do enough with monetary policy, and will fiscal policy be able to do enough in the next downturn, whenever it occurs, that we can react to bring the economy back out in a relatively short period of time? If not, you run the risk of a very extended period of very low interest rates, pretty high unemployment rates, and that's exactly what Europe has been facing since they've had their problems. They still have not brought their monetary policy into a more normalized situation. Parts of Europe are still experiencing very elevated unemployment rates. So that's something we have to be worried about. Are we really prepared for the next recession? I actually did a Boston Globe editorial about that, including locally, thinking about how your rainy day funds are allocated at the state level. If you're a business, what capacity do you have to withstand a recession, particularly if interest rates stayed low for a long period of time? So I'm not saying that we have a panacea. I'm not saying there's no concerns in the world. I do think that they are reasonable risks that we have to be thinking about, but I am particularly concerned about that one risk, which is, do we have enough policy space to react to whatever that shock is? That shock may be completely internationally driven, but if it forces our economy to a much weaker state, how are we going to react at that time?
And of course, another aspect of low interest rates is they force investors out the yield curve to get a higher rate of return. And I think we saw this a lot in the 2000s, which people forget that was the first jobless recovery. Productivity was pretty good, but but we had very slow job growth coming out of the dot-com bust in the early 2000s. And I think it was 2002, 2003, the Fed didn't move rates down as much as the markets thought they would, and we got into a revised communications process to try to make things clearer. The more certain markets are that interest rates aren't going to rise, the more they force themselves out the yield curve, getting higher and higher rates of interest and mispricing risk often. So that was a discussion that we used to have about mispricing risk. You might see a little bit of that in the leverage loan market these days. So I mean, I don't think we're anywhere near there, but that's a risk kind of on the other side.
Yeah, I agree. We actually did a Federal Reserve conference this year on what were the costs of low interest rates for a long period of time.
Yeah.
And you were on a college board, but if you look at what the distribution of investments are now, they're disproportionately
yep.
in private equity,
yep.
and the composition's very different from the stock bond allocation they
yep.
had before. So those risks that some institutions, some pension funds are taking, is also reflected, and that's how private equity gets some of its funding.
Mm-hmm.
But you do worry about if you're putting too much leverage into the economy.
Yep. Yes.
Joe McHugh. There's a lot of press about from mid-21 to mid-23, there's this huge bubble of corporate debt that's going to come due. And why is that not any different than the 2006-2007 bubble, since a lot of that debt was issued with very easy covenants, covenant light, no covenants, that are not expected to be around when that debt matures. And most people start renewing that at least a year in advance, starting middle of next year.
Yeah, so I think that's really, your last statement is the most important part of that, which is the rollover risk. So if the economy's doing well and the firm's doing well, the rollover risk isn't all that great. But if the economy's not doing well and the firm's not doing well, the rollover risk becomes appreciable. And so one of the issues with a lot of debt is that if you're not very good at the timing, you do run a risk that that rollover risk becomes quite elevated at the time you want to turn it over. And if you think about our labor markets are already tight, some of the demographics that we were already talking about, you're probably talking about an economy out in the out years as being relatively slow growth. And if it is relatively slow growth, the margin of error is not all that great to avoiding a recession. I'm not forecasting a recession, but I think it does get tricky if you're only growing at a little bit around 2% or even slower as you get to 2021, 2022. But that's an economy where if mistakes were to occur, you would be concerned that there'd be a more appreciable slowdown at the same time that some of that debt comes due. So I think that's one of the issues with a highly levered economy, is that rollover risk becomes magnified.
Now we have time for one more insightful question.
Steve Ford, building on your discussions, a couple of the questions earlier about the workforce, our global company does a global survey of thousands of HR directors around the world, and they keep talking about how dramatically work is changing and the workforce needed is changing. You talked about manufacturing being computer controlled. And in this last recession, we seem to have lost a certain percentage of the population that couldn't adapt and didn't get reemployed. How competitive are we going forward, given the rapidly increasing change in the type of work that's going to be needed in the next few years?
It just highlights a very important role of education, and that's education at all levels, from preschool to high school to college to graduate school. The kinds of skills we're going to need is a much more adaptable workforce, much more comfortable with computers, computer sciences, math. So if you have a deficient math skills, and it starts when you're very young and it doesn't improve over time, it's going to be much harder to be employable in the future, particularly if we have a down cycle. And it also means that if you start a job, you can't assume you're going to be in that same job 40 or 50 years down the road, that you're going to have to adapt just like your firm has to adapt. And that's an uncomfortable spot for many people, but we're going to have to get better at making sure that we retrain people through their careers.
There, at a point in time, the National Association of Manufacturers used to run schools, training programs that were paid for by their membership to train people to higher levels of technology on a manufacturing floor. I don't think that's as done as much anymore. We've been discussing this at the Mass Business Roundtable for exactly the reasons you mentioned, because people are so concerned about the availability of labor, the kind of labor that they need to make the industries that are growing in Massachusetts continue to thrive. When I got here, Massachusetts business was involved in ed reform, and maybe we have to take some responsibility for that again. I don't know.
A tight labor market is a market where firms are going to have to spend more money making sure that the workforce stays up to speed. So I mentioned a couple advantages to having a tight labor market. Another one is that you get more programs such as workforce development. If you can't hire externally, you have to find a way to make sure that your internal workforce can do the work. So I think that is a positive, actually, that we're probably going to be in an environment where firms are going to have to spend more money on making sure that their workforce stays up and has the kind of skills that they actually need going forward.
And I'd be remiss in saying that that also creates an environment for greater diversity, greater gender equity in the workforce. So if you need everybody working for you, working at the max, you need to treat them well.
Completely agree.
Okay, we have been just so fortunate to have Eric spend this time with us today. Please give him a hand for the amazing credit. I just have a couple of things to mention. Thank you all for being with us this morning. It's another busy year for the